Emmerton almost single-handedly built in Salem the first settlement house association on Boston's North Shore. A year after founding the association in 1907, she bought the nearby Turner Ingersoll Mansion and inaugurated the House of the Seven Gables Settlement Association. Deftly weaving together historic preservation, colonial revival, literary and historic tourism, and Salem's history of the supernatural, Emmerton was able to use the idea of the House of the Seven Gables to promote and pay for her settlement house programs. She wrote, "If, as is generally conceded, the settlements do the best Americanization work, should not this settlement excel those whose home is the ancient House of the Seven Gables, the foundations of which were laid by the first immigrants who came here long ago, strangers in a strange land?" In this one building is the culmination of multiple strands of progressive movements that shape the America of today. But Emmerton was not satisfied to rest on the accomplishments of the initial restoration. An incorporator of the Society for the Preservation of New England Antiquities, SPNEA, Emmerton saved other Salem buildings threatened with demolition. In 1911, working with SPNEA, she acquired the Hooper Hathaway House, known then as the Old Bakery. In 1915, an agent for SPNEA purchased the option to a small 17th century Salem house, the Retired Beckett House, and also conveyed it to Miss Emmerton. She had both buildings moved from their original sites to the vicinity of the House of the Seven Gables, and then had each completely restored by Chandler. Like the House of the Seven Gables before them, these new buildings served multiple purposes, primarily as an expanded institutional campus, offering additional space for offices, programs, and lodging for settlement house workers, as well as new tourist draws and continued publicity for the complex with the installation of each new building. From Chandler's perspective, the additions helped him to assemble one of several open-air museums he designed during his career. First implemented in Scandinavia several decades before, the open-air museum allowed visitors to examine a variety of vernacular buildings in a large-scale museum-like setting. Chandler completed the complex in 1924 with the addition of a barn and a colonial garden, one of numerous period gardens that Chandler designed throughout his career. Emmerton told the story of the restorations in a book she published in 1935, The Chronicles of Three Old Houses. The book allowed her to document her work and ensure her legacy. Emmerton detailed the acquisition and renovation of the Turner Ingersoll, Hooper Hathaway, and Retired Beckett houses from her perspective. She was able to demonstrate her knowledge of colonial architecture, support some of the more controversial aspects of the renovation process, and provide another item to sell to tourists in the gift shop at the Gables. The book also demonstrates one final aspect of the progressive agenda, opening up public roles for those in groups that have long been marginalized in society. Just as colleagues such as Jane Addams found careers for women in the settlement house movement, these other new fields allowed a new stage for achievements, where women could be recognized for their actions. The settlement house movement and the historic preservation movement both offered new channels for achievements by widowed or single women, such as Caroline Emmerton, and their allies and working partners, lesbians and gay men, such as Jane Addams and Joseph Everett Chandler. Relatively unknown today, Chandler was celebrated a century ago for restoring such Massachusetts architectural icons as Boston's Paul Revere House and the Old State House. This obscurity is surprising for a man once acclaimed by the press as an architectural Sherlock Holmes. A journalist writing in 1913 for the Boston Evening Transcript, the Society newspaper, described Chandler as the architectural equivalent of Arthur Conan Doyle's scientific deductive sleuth. The journalist analyzed Chandler's approach to restoring the Paul Revere House. This particular task of restoration resolved itself into architectural detective work. You went sleuthing among rafters, walls, plastering, and floor sills. The architect who undertook this work knew the type characteristics of the 17th century house in New England. The job became one of inference, from a lower sill, shaped by the opening and shutting of a framework, it was clear that the original windows had been casements swinging outward. From exit moldings, it was possible to reconstruct the interior woodwork. From half a dozen authentic clapboards of a design obviously authentic, the whole exterior was clapboarded with an effect of texture in its OG molding and scarfed ends, which places the aspect at a glance as previous to the 18th century. The detection of these details was due to the painstaking inspection of every foot of wall in the old building as it was opened by Mr. Joseph Everett Chandler, the architect in charge. In the same manner, discovering the true outlines of Chandler's career requires considerable sleuthing today. Though Chandler donated his plans, correspondence, and office files to the Massachusetts Horticultural Society, all were destroyed after his death through either their callous indifference or outright hostility. But evidence recently gathered reveals Chandler was an accomplished architect of original designs, a pioneering architectural historian, an innovative museum designer, especially in period rooms, and a founder of the historic preservation movement in New England. Chandler's work establishes direct links from the aesthetic and arts and crafts movement to the colonial revival and historic preservation. The key to unlocking the mysteries of Chandler's career was a shoebox full of 25 leather-bound booklets, each slightly larger than a deck of cards. In 2005, Historic New England acquired Chandler's personal diaries. Writing in a tiny, looping script that I think only I yet can decipher, Chandler reported his two lifelong passions, gardening and music. But sprinkled throughout are thousands of observations on his architectural practice, business partners, suppliers, and contractors, his research and writing, and investigations of now long-vanished buildings. The diaries reveal a prolific five-decade career of over 500 consultations and commissions for an elite clientele always searching for the next new old house, either on Beacon Hill or far from Boston. The clues to Chandler's circle and his career emerged slowly, literally day by day. On January 26th of 1919, Chandler encountered his friend and neighbor Alfred Cutting, the antiquarian and photographer in Sudbury, quote, standing outside of an old house just torn down, about the oldest in this locality, will be sadly received, for although damaged and ransacked and spoiled, it was very picturesque, unquote. In July of that same year, Chandler guided a group of Plymouth preservationists through the Harrison Gray Otis House on Lime Street, and the Paul Revere House, they being interested in restorations on account of saving the Lothrop House. In 1925, Chandler details scavenging for architectural salvage in the old houses between Otis House and the Charles River, then being torn down for the widening of Cambridge Street. Although no diaries exist for the years that he spent restoring the House of the Seven Gables, his later diaries offer tantalizing glimpses. Chandler led a generation of New Englanders who restored old houses in the first decades of the 20th century. All were born during or shortly after the Civil War and died within 5 years of the Second World War. Chandler, William Sumner Appleton, Frank Shuto Brown, George Francis Dow, Norman Isham, Wallace Nutting, and their colleagues shaped our understanding of early American architecture through their restorations. Here, for example, is Brown's restoration plan for the Abigail Adams birthplace in Weymouth. Discovered this when I was doing their National Register nomination. And here's the first step in that celebration, the rescue and relocation of the building. Of this group, and I love here, the woman who was the leading light here, standing on the side of the truck and directing the movement down the street. And notice the two guys sitting on top of the truck, you see what they're there for? So that when they come to branches or wires, they can lift them up. Of this group, Brown, Chandler, and Isham were trained as architects and wrote as historians, but neither of Chandler's colleagues made his primary practice in restoring houses to the extent that Chandler did. Subsequent generations of architects and historians have struggled to understand the work of these restorers. Chandler's diaries provided unique insight. For example, on examining Wallace Nutting's 1915 restoration of the ironworks house in Saugus, Chandler wrote that it was, quote, an overdone exterior, whatever the intention may be. Joe Chandler was born in Plymouth, Massachusetts, the son of Albert Chandler, a butcher. Albert bought this stagecoach stable and turned it into a successful express company in the years before the automobile. Joe Chandler was a direct descendant of 8 Mayflower passengers, including Governor William Bradford and Elder William Brewster. In 1920, during the Plymouth tercentenary, Chandler applied to become a member of the Mayflower Society and served on its board. Chandler grew up in this long-banished colonial house on Court Street in Plymouth. The 1719 Ebenezer Curtis house had an even older garden arranged in a series of dikes or terraces leading from Main Street up to Burial Hill above the town. As a boy, Joe Chandler tended this colonial garden, shown here in a Chandler photograph donated to SPNEA, now Historic New England, by his family. Chandler's last surviving architectural blueprints were a recreation of this garden. Henry Russell Hitchcock, the architectural critic and early champion of modernism, also grew up in Plymouth, in a neo-colonial house, as he termed it, that Chandler had designed for Hitchcock's grandfather, a Plymouth antiquarian. Plymouth is in a lot of ways sort of the South Shore equivalent to Salem. In his essay, Modern Architecture, a memoir, Hitchcock observed that, quote, Plymouth was, and still is, peculiarly historical-minded and backward-looking. As part of the family business, young Joe Chandler would often take wealthy tourists on carriage tours past Plymouth Rock and other landmarks. And even as an adult who lived in Boston, Chandler performed in the commemorative concerts, parades, and pageants produced in Plymouth. Chandler entered the architecture program at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology in 1885. Part of the first generation of university-trained architects in the United States. His 1886 diary documents his architecture studies at MIT, which was then in Boston's Back Bay. Chandler and his classmates formed a sketching club and traveled to Hingham to draw old colonial houses. At MIT, Chandler made the professional connections that established his career. Chandler's draftsman positions included a summer internship for McKim, Mead, and White in New York City. Chandler's diaries provide new insights on the daily working of this legendary firm. C. Howard Walker, an MIT lecturer, gave Chandler his first drafting job after college and collaborated with Chandler on this cutaway cross-section drawing of the Parthenon. But like Louis Sullivan before him, Chandler left MIT in Boston without graduating and eventually went west to Chicago. Chandler apprenticed with Burnham and Root, the great Chicago architectural firm headed by Daniel Burnham and John Wellborn Root, while that firm was designing the Monadnock Building, the tallest masonry supported building ever built. Perhaps more influential for Chandler's career was his work next for the Gilded Age decorator William Prettyman, an Englishman well connected with the aesthetic and arts and crafts movements. Prettyman designed lavish interior spaces for Burnham and Root, as well as H.H. Richardson, such as the Glessner House in Chicago. Prettyman was a frequent collaborator with his countryman Walter Crane. Crane completed several murals for Prettyman Interiors. Just recently, I was able to confirm Chandler's participation in a specific Prettyman project, the redecoration of the Second Presbyterian Church in Chicago in 1888. Chandler was credited for his work alongside Prettyman and John Elliott, the artist best known in Boston for his ceiling mural at the Boston Public Library. Despite these promising connections, Chandler was drawn back to Boston in 1890. Upon Chandler's return, Arthur Roach, sponsor of the Roach Traveling Scholarship, hired him as a draftsman. For Roach and Tilden, Chandler was lead architect for the Plymouth High School, which today is Plymouth Town Hall. Chandler likely took inspiration for this design from the courthouse at Williamsburg, Virginia, which Chandler illustrated 2 years later in his 1892 book, The Colonial Architecture of Maryland, Pennsylvania, and Virginia. Chandler brought to his work a keen interest in rediscovering the history of American architecture. Colonial architecture is a portfolio of photographs that documents important historic Mid-Atlantic buildings, including Carter's Grove, Clydeden, Farmington, Harwood House, Westover, Whitehall, and the University of Virginia. A specialty publication designed to give architects and draftsmen examples of colonial work to copy, the book found a much wider audience and was reprinted three times over the next decade. Publishers Bates and Gill, actually Chandler's architecture classmates from MIT, claimed it as, quote, one of the standard works, having had a larger sale than any other work on colonial architecture. Bates and Gills bought the rights to a similar portfolio by James Corner and Eric Soderholtz, examples of domestic colonial architecture in New England, and republished the portfolios as a set, claiming, quote, every owner of the first probably has the second, and every owner of the second should have the first. Together, these two portfolios established for the first time the canon of American colonial and federal architecture. Chandler's earliest known solo commission is Bayswater, the Fay Wright House in Plymouth, a gambrel-roofed summer cottage equal parts colonial revival and shingle style. Chandler added other estate buildings and expanded the house several times over three decades. It's still intact. It's a wonderful house. These stores in Plymouth, their Flemish bond brick walls, picturesquely studded with burnt headers, also are early works. Like other architects of the era, Chandler designed suburban copies of the Hancock House in Boston, whose demolition occurred the same year Chandler was born. The Hancock House became an icon for both preservationists and colonial revival architects. This Brookline House was one of a half dozen Hancock adaptation houses that Chandler designed and built. But Chandler's houses incorporated the latest planning principles, and that flexibility is important when we're thinking about the work here at the House of Seven Gables. Henry Russell Hitchcock, recalling his family's Chandler-designed home in Plymouth, observed that the house was not at all archaeologically colonial, despite a living room fireplace mantel copied from McIntyre. Its plan, though compact and rectangular, has practically as much spatial flow as Frank Lloyd Wright's earliest houses of the same years. And like them, it is in the continuing tradition of the shingle style. In three towns near Plymouth, Chandler adapted icons of colonial American architecture for patron-sponsored town libraries. The Kingston Library of 1896 grew from the central block of Homewood, one of Chandler's favorite colonial designs, which he termed Baltimore's most remarkable house of all, unique among all colonial buildings of America. Chandler's library in Duxbury, dedicated in 1909, was in the Italian Renaissance Revival style commonly used for libraries. But it also shows the influences of federal architecture of Virginia, such as the core of Thomas Jefferson's Monticello. The Duxbury Library, with its enormous black cypress mantelpiece, recently was restored for the local historical society. Many of Chandler's clients were the society elite and arts professionals, such as Edward Waldo Forbes, longtime director of the Fogg Art Museum at Harvard, for whom Chandler designed this 1911 Georgian and federal detailed brick house. Also like Frank Lloyd Wright, Chandler led his clients to choose appropriate furnishings, or Chandler designed pieces himself. He designed colonial revival silverware for Gebelein, the prominent Boston silversmith, for a special presentation to West Point Military Academy. In 1912, Chandler designed a private art gallery in Brookline for Desmond Fitzgerald. An engineer, Fitzgerald was patron and collector of Impressionist art. His collection included works by Degas, Monet, Pissarro, Renoir, and Sisley. But his great passion was the career of the American Impressionist W. Dodge McKnight, who had painted with Van Gogh in France. Fitzgerald wrote a monograph on McKnight. Close friends with both men, Chandler was also an early admirer and collector of McKnight's work. Chandler painted landscapes with McKnight and often visited the artist Barnstable studio, which he partially redesigned before their bitter falling out in 1940, documented in later diaries. Chandler's most widely published residential design was not colonial at all, but arts and crafts, These 1902 houses were featured in both American Architect and Building News and House Beautiful, announcing Chandler's work to professional and popular audiences both. For bachelor John Goodfellow Ramsbottom, Chandler designed a bungalow in the Norwegian style with a boulder foundation, brick chimney, and log walls, a sort of Valhalla on Earth with an enormous two-story central hall. The half-timbered house next door for Ramsbottom's close friend, Ernest Sharp, was an adaptation of the 1650s God's Providence House in Chester, England. The Tudor-style Sturges House in Brookline is reminiscent of the work of English architect C.F.A. Voysey. Chandler's work directly links the aesthetic and arts and crafts movements with the Colonial Revival. Chandler designed at least two dozen newer restored houses for lesbian and gay clients. Perhaps the best example was Red Roof on Eastern Point in Gloucester, with its sliding panels and secret rooms, which Chandler drew up for Harvard professor A. Pyatt Andrew in 1902. Keenly interested in the arts, Andrew first met Chandler in 1894. Chandler took him to a Monet exhibition and they became friends. In 1899, they met again in Paris, and Chandler shepherded Andrew to Durand Ruel and the French galleries. By 1905, Andrew was expanding Red Roof on his own with the help of his decorator and admirer, Henry Sleeper. 2 years later, Sleeper, a colleague who several times referred clients to Chandler, built Beauport just down the road from Red Roof, starting a colony that included Andrew's student Franklin Delano Roosevelt, Isabella Stewart Gardner, and others of their circle among its guests. Chandler designed over 100 new buildings, most in the Colonial Revival style clients prefer, although sometimes he used other revivals. In 1930, Chandler confided to his diaries, quote, "I commenced to make elevations of the Tainter House in Topsfield at 1/8-inch scale. Such a relief to do something in Gothic rather than always colonial." But the deepening depression and the successive mental breakdowns of first Mr. Tainter and then Mrs. Tainter doomed Chandler's late Tudor Revival masterpiece, which, despite its salvaged English period interiors, remained an unfinished shell, haunted for decades until its demolition. Completed Chandler works included a town hall, houses for tutors at an elite private school, Dartmouth fraternity houses, and the college gates at Wellesley, suburban neighborhoods, and this palatial suburban estate for Chandler's wealthy older traveling companion, Horace Sears. In this estate, Chandler incorporated architectural salvage from their European trips and designed a fireplace wall with ruby tile and sculpture by John Evans. In several projects, Chandler used tile by Henry Mercer. Chandler visited Mercer in his Doylestown, Pennsylvania home and factory complex more than once. Praised by Fisk Kimball and Henry Russell Hitchcock, Chandler's second and much more influential book was The Colonial House, 1916. Chandler wrote it for the readers of Shelter magazines, but found a wider readership eager for his broad knowledge of colonial architecture. Chandler addresses his readers as clients looking to build a new colonial house or to restore an old colonial. Preferring simple designs, Chandler lampoons the over-garnished excesses of the early colonial revival, which he describes as, quote, pure hoppegee colonial. Chandler sneered that, quote, "This regrettable period of our architectural history has left its mark and still lives under the new mask of a hybrid-headed monster, masquerading as colonial." Chandler derided some of the more ornate and oversized colonial revival houses of his colleagues as, quote, "virulent colonial, specimens of a disordered fancy, kickapoo colonial." He wrote an entire chapter entitled, "What Not to Do." In contrast to the hoppegee, Chandler's own later revival taste can be seen best in this 1926 house on Cape Cod, the exhibition house for a new housing development. A half dozen Chandler designs were built before the developer went bankrupt. The house draws closely on the vernacular architecture Chandler sketched and measured on trips across the Cape. Nothing kickaboo here. Its expanded Cape form and saltbox profile roof allow Chandler to fit a spacious floor plan within a compact form. But Chandler devoted most of the colonial house to a detailed examination of the development of early American architecture, such as this comparison of the successive doors of the Royal House in Medford, another of his restorations. Chandler defined colonial architecture as the unbroken movement from the first period through federal, a movement that ultimately dashed itself against the stones of the Greek Revival in a chapter he entitled The Downfall. Once again, Chandler's book found a wider audience than expected, not just the general public, but also historians interested in his wide-ranging knowledge of colonial architecture. Chandler's preeminence in the field led to an invitation to write architectural monographs on colonial colleges, 1915, the first essay in the innovative White Pine series. Though more consciously historical, these publications were supported by advertisements by lumber, paint, stain, and building companies, trying to tap into the market for the colonial revival and colonial restoration architecture. The series published detailed photographs, measured drawings, and flimsy descriptions of important architectural landmarks. In his second White Pine publication, Some Charleston Mansions, Chandler drew on his trips to Charleston, where he went to see the gardens as much as the architecture. While he was in Charleston, Chandler met with Susan Pringle Frost, the founder of the preservation movement in Charleston, and advised her on the restoration of the iconic Miles Bruton and Joseph Manigault houses. Of course, Chandler is most remembered for his restorations. That's why we're here tonight. Chandler's first large-scale remodeling is of an historic house is his reworking of the 1753 Winslow House in Plymouth, Massachusetts, for Charles Willoughby, a New Englander keenly interested in history. Willoughby was responsible for the cyclorama craze of the 1880s, commissioning the 365-foot-long Battle of Gettysburg and its copies. At Willoughby's request in 1898, Chandler tore off the Winslow House's later back additions, moved the front across the lot, and reconstructed the rest of the house from new materials, adding a cupola, balustrades, royal crest, two large rear wings, and formal gardens. Criticized for his work there, Chandler changed his approach on his next commission. At the Dorothy Quincy Homestead in 1904, his earliest museum restoration, Chandler removed only some of the later 19th century additions, such as porches, a balcony, and a mansard roofed addition. But Chandler retained other later elements. He used innovative techniques such as view windows and hinged structural post casings, hinging even an entire paneled chimney breast so that later finishes could be opened to reveal earlier elements they covered, a practice that became a standard restoration technique and one that they're thinking of using in the new secret room as they work to restore and interpret it here at House in Seven Gables. Chandler pioneered a new approach to restoration architecture in Boston. In the late 1890s, university-trained architects directed restoration projects where, in the name of fireproofing or structural engineering, they completely gutted historic buildings. Faneuil Hall, designed by John Smybert in 1740 and expanded by Charles Bulfinch in 1805, was gutted out to its bare brick walls, everything replaced with iron and steel replicas. Bulfinch's State House was selectively disemboweled. The Old South Meeting House was decapitated, the entire roof frame and decks torn off and replaced by steel trusses. In 1905, Boston Brahmins decided to restore the Paul Revere House as a patriotic symbol for the North End's Italian, Irish, and Jewish immigrants. But instead of creating a shrine to Revere, Chandler used the fundraising campaign to give Boston a more challenging architectural symbol. The oldest surviving wooden house in downtown Boston restored on its exterior to its 17th century form, 90 years before Revere lived there. In his introduction to Charles Hosmer's Presence of the Past, Walter Muir Whitehill joked that, quote, Paul Revere, were he to return to North Square, would not recognize the house in which he long lived. But Chandler's intent was architectural, not memorial, and his carefully delineated 17th and 18th century period rooms show that his choices were calculated, not careless. Chandler preserved historic wallpapers in place, and again used hinged casings. Where his colleagues imposed scientific solutions on structural problems, Chandler began his work with a knowledge of and respect for colonial craftsmanship. For four decades, Chandler worked closely with William Sumner Appleton. In 1900, they together produced measured drawings of the 1679 Providence House in Boston. By the way, in 1922, Chandler wrote in his diary, "Stopped and saw the old chimney of the Providence House, now being demolished, to make room for a large block and theater. Saw two splendid old fireplaces of the earliest period. There were six, with herringbone in back and fire beams intact. A most picturesque ruin, a great pity it had to go." Appleton served as secretary of the Paul Revere Association, experience that led to his chartering the Society for the Preservation of New England Antiquities in 1910. Appleton and Chandler manipulated the patriotic campaign to preserve the Paul Revere House. The butt of Whitehill's joke is not really Chandler, but rather those perplexed Bostonians who paid for a shrine to Paul Revere, but got instead an architectural icon a century before. Other Chandler restoration projects in Boston include the Old State House, in Gloucester, the Saunders House Sawyer Free Library, and the Sergeant Murray Gilman House. Its terraced garden leading down towards the harbor repeats aspects of Chandler's boyhood garden in Plymouth. In Lancaster, Chandler restored the horse barns of the Bullfinch Church. In Medford, the Isaac Royal House. In Plymouth, the Harlow Spooner and Antiquarian Society houses. Outside Massachusetts, Chandler restored the Purcell Lane and Lord House in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, Nathan Hale House in Connecticut, Morgan Farm in Virginia, Shell Castle in North Carolina, and the Long Island, New York House of Howard Sherwood, founder of the Society for the Preservation of Long Island Antiquities, which Sherwood cattily nicknamed Snarling Hollow. Chandler drew up plans for the Aptuxet Trading Post reconstruction in Warren, which brought him directly into conflict again with his nemesis, Salem's own George Francis Dow. Dow beat out Chandler in designing the colonial period room installations of the American wing of the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York City. Perhaps Chandler's most interesting institutional restoration was his work for the Harvard Musical Association in Beacon Hill. Chandler was intimately acquainted with 57A Chestnut Street, where he'd rented a room since October 1896, when the building was still oriented toward West Cedar Street. Between 1905 and 1907, Chandler gutted the ground floor of the townhouse, dropping the floor level into the basement 4 feet for a large performance space in front and a library in the rear. Initially, Chandler proposed a Colonial Revival interior with feathered woodwork and plaster walls, but the final design was much less formal. A dark wood-paneled gentleman's club. He finished the room in southern cypress with casement windows and two large Dutch fireplaces. Arts and crafts derived details included the wooden balustrades between the rooms and bricks purchased from the Society of Arts and Crafts in Boston. In place of the flat plaster federal ceiling he first proposed, Chandler used a framework of boxed beams, which greatly improved its acoustics. The renovation space was formally opened in 1907. On the exterior, Chandler replaced the sash windows with casement windows and transoms, adjusting for the change in floor level. And then in 1908, Chandler completed restoration of an upper story, upper two stories for another large performance space. The great majority of Chandler's restorations, though, were not for museums, but for private dwellings. Many were on Beacon Hill. Beacon Hill, as we know it today, owes much of its present character to Chandler and other architects active a century ago, who restored its federal era buildings, then unfashionable and long eclipsed by the Back Bay, for a new generation of bankers and businessmen. During these first decades of the 20th century, Chandler maintained offices on Parker Beacon Streets and restored or rebuilt dozens of Beacon Hill houses, including 16 on Chestnut Street alone. For the Wellington family, Chandler restored both the Swan townhouses and the Swan stables. There we go. Many more restorations became country estates, such as the Stevens Coolidge Place in North Andover. Who's been there? Chandler's diaries bring to life the many layers of Boston society that made restorations possible. The wealthy Brahmins and socially ascended businessmen and professionals who financed the work, the emerging profession of preservationists, architects, artists, decorators, and museum professionals who planned the work, the contractors and artisans who carried out the work, and the businesses and specialists who supplied them, including antiques dealers and house scavengers, such as Israel Sack and Holden Green. These restorations were of such quality that many later became museums. Stevens Coolidge is now the property of the Trustees of Reservations. Another prime example is the Hooper Lee Nichols House, which Chandler restored and modernized for Austin White in Cambridge on Tory Road. Chandler promoted the emerging museum study of American handicrafts. He collected furniture and restored private houses as showplaces for furniture aficionados, such as his friends in the Walpole Society, the Collectors Association founded in 1910. For Chauncey Nash, Chandler moved two houses to Cohasset, Massachusetts and reconstructed them. Chandler counseled Edward Hipkiss, curator of the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, and he led the planners of the American wing of the Metropolitan Museum of New York on tours of New England houses. Chandler lamented to his desire after the design for the Met's American wing went to Dow and other colleagues. Atterbury was the architect, and therefore Jack Tompkins was in it when curiously I had been in it at the start. Same old story when there is a big plum. William Sumner Appleton often recommended Chandler to potential clients. In 1913, Appleton corresponded with the New Hampshire governor, Robert Perkins Bass, who sought an architect to produce a new house of the very oldest type. Appleton gave Bass a reading list, an itinerary of old houses to tour, and directions on summer beams, chamfering overhangs, and casement windows. The resulting house in Peterborough that Chandler designed for the Basses has a stunning view of Mount Monadnock from a dining room reminiscent of the Paul Revere House, and it's still in the Bass family today. Chandler's single most ambitious restoration was Storrowton, a project undertaken for longtime friend and patron Helen Osborne Storrow. Like Emmerton and Storrow, more than 40 of Chandler's clients were independent, single, or widowed women. Storrowton was built on the grounds of the Eastern States Exposition in West Springfield, Massachusetts. Who's been to Storrowton? Employing George Francis Dow's carpenter brother, Eugene, in the work there. Chandler wrote in his diary, quote, that he received an amusing letter from Sumner Appleton bewailing the fact that I had engaged Eugene Dow in the Springfield work, as it was seemingly interfering with the work being done in Watertown for him. He also hoped that Mrs. Storrow would not be gathering up houses here and there and transporting them to fairgrounds, taking them from their original settings. Well, that's, of course, exactly what she was doing. Chandler scouted dozens of endangered buildings and added a lawyer's office, mansion house, stone blacksmith shop, brick schoolhouse, townhouse, and a Cape Cod cottage. The tavern and barn came from towns doomed by the Quabbin Reservoir. Begun at almost the same time as Greenfield Village and Colonial Williamsburg, Storrowton is an important open-air museum. It was also the inspiration for Old Sturbridge Village. Albert Wells toured Storrowton and then commissioned this early village plan from Chandler. Chandler was bitterly disappointed when Wells hired more prominent architects, Perry, Shaw, and Hepburn, to undertake the work. Characteristically, Wells threw them over as well. Helen Storrow also championed modern architecture, providing land from her estate to Walter Gropius, the Harvard professor who had led the Bauhaus in Germany, and Marcel Breuer to build houses. While not a modernist, Chandler liked modernist work, especially the house his friend Nathaniel Saltonstall designed for himself in Medfield in 1937. Saltonstall later founded the Institute of Contemporary Art in Boston. Chandler's diaries describe meeting Gropius at dinners at Storrow's estate. Chandler took Storrow through Saltonstall's house twice, explaining its modern elements. Shortly thereafter, Storrow welcomed the modernist to Lincoln. It may not be a complete stretch to say that the colonial house made possible the modern house in America. Like Chandler, Saltonstall was, to some circles, openly gay, and it appears that the obscurity of both today is at least partially due to the homophobia of the 1940s and 1950s. Chandler did not throw the wild, notorious parties that Sultan Stark did. But Chandler refused to marry socially and strategically as many of his contemporaries, such as Ogden Codman, had. He proudly remained, as he named his estate in Sudbury, Manholm. For those who understood the context, the connotations of this nickname were very clear. In this image, the stone building in the lower right corner is the house's first built. The complex at the top is Chandler's ill-advised major expansion that he carried out in 1929 and was never able to pay for. While Chandler's friendship with William Sumner Appleton strained under several disagreements as they grew older, they continued to work together. In 1934, Chandler drove Appleton to Plymouth for another investigation and complained to his diary. Sumner finally stirred his stumps a half hour later. We got off. In 1937, Appleton, quite rightly as it turns out, criticized Chandler's work on the fireplace at the Warner House in Portsmouth, New Hampshire. But Appleton added a conciliatory note to his old friend of four decades. Quote, it is funny enough to laugh at, but tragic enough to cry about. The moral of which is, Joseph, my friend, that you and I, at the cost of time, patience, and perhaps of money, have always got to do a lot of dirty work that the local committee forgets about. Accordingly, in your next incarnation, be careful to avoid any leaning towards antiquarianism. After Chandler's death, Appleton wrote several letters attempting to secure Chandler's papers for SPNEA. By acquiring his diaries today, Historic New England, which is in a sense Appleton's reincarnation, helped restore Chandler's legacy. One more house, and then I'll go back to the House of Seven Gables. I hope this overview of Chandler's career gives context for some of the choices he made in the House of Seven Gables. Varied aspects of his career intertwine in interesting ways. Take, for example, this wonderful first period house on Garden Street in Cambridge, largest of three commissions that Chandler undertook in 1922 for the family of Henry B. Day, an investment banker and philanthropist. Mrs. Day was a patron of the North Bennett Street School. It was built for Henry's son Frederick, a journalist. It's a direct adaptation of the House of the Seven Gables and other early houses. On October 9, 1922, Chandler and Day traveled north of Boston to visit several first period landmarks. Chandler wrote in his diary, went with Frederick Day, our client, to Topsfield, visiting the old Parson Capon house, restored by Dow. Capon house, on the whole, disappointing. Some queer things done by Dow in restoration. Then to the Hart House at Ipswich to lunch, the Whipple House. And finally, the House of the Seven Gables, where I was astonished to hear how the authenticity of the chimney I designed had grown up around its story of the House of the Seven Gables. The rambling cross-gabled 19-room Day House in Cambridge is an arts and crafts exercise filled with first-period details that Chandler adapted from Essex County houses, including jetties and pendant drops, chamfered exposed beams, shouldered posts, open fireplaces, casement windows, dogleg staircases, and pine paneling. So, what are the secrets of the restoration of the House of the Seven Gables? First of all, is it actually the house described by Hawthorne in his novel? Well, certainly Hawthorne was acquainted with the house and its eccentric inhabitant, his cousin Susan Ingersoll. He did set the House of the Seven Gables in Salem and drew on many aspects of Salem's history. The Turner Ingersoll house had long been connected with the house in the novel, although some of those connections were alleged by Susanna Ingersoll's heir and completely unprovable. While the rebuilding of the House of the Seven Gables did reveal features described by Hawthorne, it's important to remember that the book is a work of fiction. These ambiguities, rather than limiting the options of Chandler and Emmerton, gave them a license to direct restoration to achieve several sets of competing objectives. When I began studying Chandler, there were many elements of his work at the House of the Seven Gables which were not understood at all. But a lot of those mysteries were resolved several years ago when the Historic Structures Report was completed, the latest Historic Structures Report. Thanks to the impeccable scholarship and literally probing investigations of Ann Grady and Finch and Rose, we have a fairly comprehensive picture of how Chandler and Emmerton restored the House of Seven Gables. When Emmerton purchased the Turner House, most of its gables had already been shorn away in later renovations. Chandler's investigation led him to restore the missing facade gables and more. By the time he finished, the house had 8 gables. Chandler made his decisions in light of competing goals. The interiors represented the 1840s of the book, while the exteriors represented the construction dates of the buildings in the late 1600s. Not everyone agreed with Chandler's interpretation of the gables. The foreman of the job, Johnny Taffy, even signed and had witnessed a statement disputing Chandler's account 32 years later in 1940. Taffy claimed that, quote, there was no evidence or indication, unquote, that gables had previously existed there. At least none that he saw. But Taffy had not worked with Chandler. Rather, he was basing his opposition on the fact that he was restoring the gables from, quote, plans provided by a Boston architect. He didn't know about Chandler's work in probing the forms of the House of the Seven Gables. He didn't even remember Chandler's name. Given the amount of changes that occurred to the frame of the house since its construction 17th century, his statement is inconclusive at best. While it does provide a cautionary to any architect who strips away centuries of architectural change and restores lost features. While Chandler's changes violate current preservation standards, certainly nothing indicates fraudulent behavior, as Taffy implies. Both Chandler and Emmerton had a lot at stake in the restoration and getting it right. Chandler, as we noted earlier, had made her peace with the restoration and provided the narrative of it in Chronicles of Three Old Houses. Her restoration is actually a pretty good read. I recommend it. Far more troubling, of course, is the secret staircase. The investigations in the historic structure report make clear that the current secret staircase was constructed by Chandler. Here's the story and depiction of the staircase in the 1913 edition of The House of Seven Gables, edited by Caroline Emmerton. And it's worth reading the text here. This shows, see, Clifford's room in The House of Seven Gables. This shows the top of the secret staircase from Clifford's room to Miss Hepzibah's sitting room. There was such a staircase in the actual house. Notice the ways in which the claim is being worded. And Hawthorne knew of it from his cousin, Suzanne Ingersoll. In the book, it is not actually mentioned, but the mysterious appearance of Clifford in the room where the judge is sitting dead seems to show that Hawthorne had it in mind. Because the chimney stacks had been substantially rebuilt, it was really impossible to know if the conjectured staircase had existed. Although anyone who has investigated old houses has seen their share of makeshift and odd staircases. What's interesting here, this series of early postcards of Clifford's room, and you notice as the postcard is reprinted, that first of all, it just shows the room, and then second of all, it opens the door to the secret staircase, and here it's wide open, so you don't miss the secret staircase. And as time went by, it became clear that there this power of the idea of the secret staircase, and this focus on the staircase. And the same sorts of elements here in the dining room. See the dining room, the House of Seven Gables, Salem, Mass. One of the earlier postcards, copyright by Caroline Emmerton. And you see at the top, showing closet at left, which has secret entrance to the secret staircase. A little later, dining room showing entrance to secret staircase, House of Seven Gables. So again, the focus shifts more and more onto the secret staircase. Other significant changes that Chandler and Emerton made in the fabric to accommodate the book and tourists include moving an entire interior wall in a foot to preserve a window seat mentioned in the book. Here we have Chandler's typically overstuffed and cluttered colonial kitchen display. And then, of course, converting part of the room back to the scent shop. But given the three worthwhile competing goals for the restoration of the house in Seven Gables, so restoring an architectural landmark, providing a staging of Hawthorne's novel, and generating tourist dollars to support the settlement work and the restored building itself, the resulting restoration naturally makes compromises. But the result is an invention, I would argue, that justifies those compromises. So what questions do you have?
Standard English design because it shed rain fairly well, but they found out that it didn't work well in New England snow. So that was a roofing detail that used.
Just thought people might be able to hear you better with this
on. Oh, okay. good. Other questions? Yeah.
Can you talk about the eighth gable a little bit more? Yeah. I read, it's always so shrouded in mystery. You know, you read that the passage in Caroline Emmerton's book, where she's like, and there was an eighth gable, but we guarded it, and the, you know, like.
It depends on how you count a gable.
Sure.
What's a gable? How do you count it? There's, some people that argue that there was a whole gable that was missed, there's not enough evidence there for me to make a convincing argument either way. I just think it's interesting that looking to recreate gables, they ended up saying, oh, there probably was one there as well. So you ended up with an extra gable.
Right, they had to start, with a lean to the square one. There's obviously no evidence of a piece of building
there.
So,
it's a complex set of questions. And again, because they wanted to preserve the interior finishes and interpret that from 1840, the time of the novel, but take the exterior of the building back. It's so
convoluted.
Lots of compromises, and things that you can't. These things logically don't cohere. So there's places where the things don't come together. So yes, the current secret staircase, wonderful it is. I just went up with my son tonight. It was built by Chandler, but it doesn't mean there wasn't a secret staircase there or someplace else in the house. Okay? And it may be a small price to pay for the continuing preservation of these historic buildings and the settlement work of the house in Seven Gables. No other place has that mix of uses and purposes. We want to be sort of purist about things and say this is right, this is wrong. But it's like way more complex than that. There's so many different layers of letters. Yeah.
Two questions. Some of the other books say, old Salem legend, that the secret staircase he referred about was in the full English house, which was on its honor.
Could have been.
Because that was one of the Hawthorne family houses too later on.
Yeah, Hawthorne himself never made a claim that it was one particular house.
Right.
But he was thinking about all the houses that he grew up with. Certainly the Turner Ingersoll house figured into the house in Seven Gables. But, it's a work of fiction, and he was thinking about how best to tell the story. Okay, so it's not a documentary of three centuries of Salem architecture. Someone else wrote that. Yeah. You go ahead and then we'll come back.
Okay, this is rather specific. I'm a guide in the Gables.
Okay.
So I'm used to looking at the fireplace in the kitchen and the herringbone bricks.
Yeah.
And I heard something earlier in your presentation about herringbone. We believe, from what I understand, that's a Colonial Revival feature and not necessarily would have been done in colonial times in that part of the house where guests would not see it. Do you agree with that?
I'm not an expert on Salem colonial architecture.
Okay.
My expertise is on Chandler. And I would say, look at the historic structure report, look at what Abbott Cummings has written about it. If they don't know, I'm certainly not going to make a claim.
because they would have a much better understanding of it. Sorry. Go ahead now.
In Caroline's book, it's been 35 years since I read it, but she had mentioned, I think, in what they call a cliff term, all the way to the left of the fireplace wall was a staircase going down and just coming into a city.
Yeah.
I don't know if you read it or remember that.
Well, you know, she wrote it in 1935. Which was, you know, decades after it had been done. She, you know, as guides, there are things that, you know, we say over and over again. Maybe sometimes we'll suddenly go, oh, wait a minute, what? Why did I think that? Was there a reason that I said that? And you know, and so again, yeah, that's what she wrote. I'm not going to second guess it beyond that. But because it's all more complex. Other questions?
I was wondering, I don't know if I missed anything. Did Emmerton bring all these buildings here? Was she responsible for collecting?
Everything except the Nathaniel Hawthorne birthplace, that was after she and Chandler.
And the Gables is on its own foundation. The other ones.
Yeah, the House of the Seven Gables was here, the other things were either moved here or built. Yeah.
What is the secret staircase?
Well, it's called the secret staircase. I just think it's, you know, yes, we could admit that the secret staircase now was designed by Chandler under Emerton's direction. That doesn't mean there wasn't a secret staircase earlier before they took down those massive chimneys. Okay.
Is there a reason for the secret staircase?
Well, it's the element it comes directly from the book, and that's the idea that's how Clifford gets from one room to another very quickly, and it's a major point in the plot. Okay. So same as the window scene. Yeah.
There was a lecture here, I don't know, 15, 20 years ago, and they talked about the secret staircase being used during the time of slavery escaping. And just doesn't work in with what you're saying.
I've never seen that.
From what I understand, that was what people believed until later evidence showed that it was built, the truth came out, right? So it's just rumors and traditions.
I would love to claim that story, but I've never heard it, and I don't know the
I didn't hear the statement. I'm sorry.
That the secret staircase was used during the Underground Railroad. Moving slaves south to Canada.
That's very common in my town because we have several houses that have big pieces from the primary road. So that has been an assumption.
Yeah. Yeah. What town is that?
Marlborough?
I'm sorry?
Marlborough?
Marlborough.
We're settled in 1660, yeah. So we have several houses.
Maybe one last question?
You had mentioned a book that you suggested to read about the history of three houses or something.
Yeah, Chronicles. There's actually a copy you sent me for sure.
Yeah, we sell the Chronicles of Three Old Houses in the bookstore.
Okay.
In our museum store.
Very cool.
Yeah, it's a fun read.
I was reading about Caroline.
Yeah, but Caroline.
Yeah, there's a member discount too, right? It's always been good.
Look in the front by the admissions desk where you came in. We actually have a page from her original handwritten notes as she was writing the Chronicles of Field House. Wow. You can see out there.
Yeah, it's kind of, there's a cabinet set up almost as a teaser for the exhibit coming up with a few of the items that will be in the exhibit.
Do you know who finalized her drawings?
I don't.
It wasn't Chandler.
God. I mean, they look very similar in the book to her drawings and her notes. So I don't know who was finalizing them.
Okay. See, there's just more questions.
Is history alive?